breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hello, my name is Fred Lane, and I am one of the former pastors here at Balmoral Bible Chapel. I want to welcome you to Balmoral's continuing series of meditations on Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, found in Matthew chapter 7. Today we are looking at Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23, and the title of our meditation this morning is examining the reality of your faith. Before I read the verses, let me open with prayer. Lord, we thank you for the privilege we have of being able to come to you in prayer, to worship you, to thank you, and to place before you our needs and concerns. And we worship you for your care and your provision for us. Lord, we are mindful that Remembrance Day is once more approaching. Thank you for the sacrifice and service of so many Canadians in our armed forces, in past wars and continuing today to safeguard our country. Lord, we pray for peace, not only in Canada, but around the world. In particular, we think at this time of our neighbors to the south. Lord, we would pray for a peaceful and beneficial conclusion to the election process going on in the United States. We pray for the healing of the divisions in that country and in our own country. Father, we ask for your mercy to end this pandemic. Give wisdom to our world's leaders and our scientists that they would successfully work together to be able to get the pandemic under control and to find a successful vaccine. We pray these things, Lord, remembering that our trust and our hope is in you. And we ask it in Jesus' name and to his glory. Amen. Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. A number of years ago, a story was told about a well-known gangster who was invited to go to a Billy Graham crusade. And when the time came in the service where Billy Graham issued the invitation for people to come forward if they wished to give their life to Christ and become a Christian, the people who invited him were delighted to see this gangster go forward and commit his life to Christ. However, their initial elation was short-lived as the days and the weeks went by and they noticed that there was no change in this gangster's life. He was still living as a gangster. His lifestyle had not changed. And so they approached him and they said, how can this be? You gave your life to Christ. You became a Christian and yet we don't see any change in your life. Well, the gangster was taken aback by their question. And as he responded, he said, well, there are Christian athletes and there are Christian doctors and Christian entertainers. Why can't there be Christian gangsters? I don't know if this story is true or not, but it does clearly illustrate the point that Jesus is making in these verses. Becoming a Christian, being brought into a right relationship with God, so one can be assured of entrance into heaven, is more than simply saying the right words. It is not a matter of words, rather, it is a matter of the heart. In fact, in this passage, Jesus addresses two of the mistaken understandings people have about how we gain eternal life, or as most people would put it, how we get to heaven. Jesus is warning us about ways in which we can be victims of self-deception regarding our status before God. First, there is the self-deception that leads us to believe that getting right with God is simply a matter of saying the right words and giving intellectual assent to certain doctrines. Such a misunderstanding has been called easy believism. Just say this prayer, and you automatically have a ticket to heaven. Jesus confronts this type of self-deception many times in the Bible. In Matthew 15, he confronts the hypocrisy of certain Pharisees by quoting to them the words of God found in the Old Testament in the book of Isaiah. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Words, even those disguised as prayers, which do not come from a changed heart, are useless. Secondly, Jesus is saying that we can also deceive ourselves into thinking that doing good deeds, even impressive ones, that may have positive effects, will gain us God's favor and ensure our entrance into His kingdom. But Jesus tells us here that good works alone will not impress God if they don't arise from a heart that has been transformed and is devoted to doing His will. God says again in the book of Isaiah that He regards our works that are done to earn His favor as filthy rags. In another instance, we are told that man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. So if getting right with God to qualify us to enter His kingdom is not a matter of saying the right words or doing the right things, how do we become fit for heaven? Jesus tells us in verse 21, when He says this, "The one who enters His kingdom is he who does the will of My Father." So what is the will of God, the Father? Listen to the clear answer given by Jesus in the Gospel of John, chapter 6 and verse 40. "For My Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in Him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up the last day." A few verses before this, some people had asked Jesus, what work does God require for people to do in order to please Him? Here was Jesus' answer. The work of God is this, to believe in the one He has sent. So the question arises, what does believing in Jesus mean? In that culture and language, to believe meant a lot more than intellectual assent. The word meant to trust fully in who Jesus was and what He said and did. Believing in Jesus means understanding more and more that my relationship with God is based upon my trusting not in what I can do, but in what Christ has already done. A true Christian, then, is one who understands the depths of his sinfulness, repents of that sin, and recognizes that Jesus, by dying on the cross, paid the price for my sin and offers to freely bestow His forgiveness on me and make me right with the Father. From that moment on, Jesus transforms my heart and makes it possible for me to become more and more like Him. The Apostle Paul put it this way, when we come to Christ, we become a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. But how do we know our heart has been transformed and that we really are Christ followers? That we are truly destined for heaven and won't be numbered with those who cry, "Lord, Lord, only to hear those terrible words, I never knew you. Here are two ways we can be assured of the reality and security of our relationship with God. Both of these ways require developing a habit of honest self-examination. First, we should examine our motives for doing the good things we do. Am I truly trusting in what Christ has done for me by his life, death, and resurrection as the only way I can be made fit for heaven? Or am I trusting in myself or in my accomplishments? Trusting in anything I can do is worthless, says Jesus. If my heart has been truly transformed, I will be trusting in Jesus alone for my future. I will do the right things for the right reasons. In other words, my motivation will not be out of selfish interests or to look good in the eyes of God or others. Instead, my motivation will be flowing out of my love for God and my love for others. We need, therefore, to ask ourselves periodically, what are my motives for doing the good works I do? Are they God-centered motives or self-centered? Are they for his glory or for mine? In addition to checking our trust level in Christ and our motives for doing good, there is a second way to be assured of the reality of our faith and that we are true followers of Christ. In 2 Peter chapter 1, Peter tells us that as Christ followers, we are to be growing in our Christ-likeness by developing certain character traits, which he lists in verses 5 to 7. Traits like goodness, patience, self-control, and love. These are all traits perfectly displayed in Christ. Peter says, the more we develop these traits, the more we look like Christ, the more confident we can be that we are chosen and called by God to be part of his eternal kingdom. We need, therefore, to regularly examine ourselves to see how we are doing in developing Christ-like character traits, as mentioned in 2 Peter 1, and also in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, where these traits are called the fruit of the Spirit. In last week's message, we learned that you can tell a good tree by the fruit it produces. Having right motivations for doing good works and developing Christ-like character traits are all part of the true believer's good fruit and give evidence of a transformed heart, a heart that is destined for eternity with Jesus. True believers will call out, Lord, Lord, but it will not be a cry from the lips only, but will stem from a heart that is surrendered to Jesus as the true Lord of his or her life. True believers will do many good works of service in the name of the Lord, but not to gain favor or merit or recognition, but out of a heart of love for God and love for others. When our words of Lord, Lord stem from a transformed heart, then the Lord's response to us will be, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's happiness. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. As we continue to reflect on and study the scriptures, Please open our eyes that we would see and be able to apply what you are teaching us, so that we will grow in Christ-likeness and in our ability to spread your light and your love. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. As you continue to reflect on what these verses are saying to you, enjoy some more worship in music from Jabin.
Recognition laying down, greatest treasures count as worthless. Standing next to heaven's crown, standing next to heaven's crown. In the cross alone our glory, ever reaching for the prize. Pressing on and laying hold of that for which my Savior died, that for which my Savior died. In the cross alone I glory, nothing of my own to give, only that which Christ has offered. It's for my soul that I may live, for my soul that I may live. In the cross alone I glory, holding fast the word of life. Toiling not in vain but being poured out as a sacrifice, poured out as a sacrifice. In the cross alone I glory, nothing of my own to give, only that which Christ has offered. That I may live, for my soul that I may live. Never will I see the glory that was never meant for me. Always heaven were reflecting, altered Jesus to receive, all to Jesus to receive. In the cross alone I glory, nothing of my own to give, only that which Christ has offered. For my soul that I may live, what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours. Righteousness, righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. So take my heart. Transform it. Take my will, conform it to yours, oh Lord. Take my heart and form it. Take my mind.
How great thou art,
great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, 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 how great thou art.
Each week at the end of the video, we like to leave you with some questions to help you continue to process the passage of Scripture we have been looking at. I hope you will spend time this week reflecting on these questions and perhaps discuss them with someone else to challenge and encourage one another. Let me leave you with the benediction from 2 Peter 3:18. Grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To Him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. Thanks for listening, and have a great week.